This inevitable conclusion of fascism is at the heart of NieR Automata's narrative. Toward the end of Route B, we're treated to this memorable scene.
His wondrous grace has become a god. His
And then, shortly thereafter, we learn this.
We installed the Council of Humanity's server on the surface of the moon.
But that means...
mankind no longer exists.
But why?
No one fights without a reason. And we need a god worth dying for.
What a bizarre juxtaposition. I wonder if the game is trying to tell us something. Fighting fascists has been a staple of commercial video games since, well, pretty much the beginning. The original Castle Wolfenstein was a stealth adventure game released in 1981 for Apple II home computers. 10 years later, it would inspire the team at id Software to create the seminal first-person shooter Wolfenstein 3D. The Wolfenstein franchise lives on to this day, with a slate of recent releases such as New Order and The New Colossus. Other game franchises, such as the original incarnations of Medal of Honor and Call of Duty, have proven that gunning down Nazis is a favorite pastime within a pastime for video games. There are also many games that feature antagonists who are analogous to fascist organizations. The obvious example would be any Star Wars video game where one opposes the Galactic Empire. We also have games like Final Fantasy VI that feature a similarly fascist-resembling regime in its Gestalian Empire. Fighting fascism is fertile ground for video game concepts. You've got clear-cut villains, obvious motivation for our protagonists, and plenty of violent struggle to convert into action-heavy gameplay and spectacle. It's a wellspring of inspiration that isn't going to run dry anytime soon. But there's a small issue with these games. Not individually, most of them are pretty great, but in aggregate. Video game narratives almost always treat fascism as an external threat, which it certainly can be. But there's not a lot of games examining the threat fascism poses from within a nation, or what life is like under a fascist regime, or about how societies come to tolerate or even encourage such cruelty. If our narratives only view fascism from the outside, we risk failing to see how it could happen here. And this is where NieR Automata, just celebrating its 5th anniversary, provides a fresh and much needed perspective. Not only that, but a thorough and deft evisceration of fascist ideology that could only be done from within it. Let's take a closer look at the brilliant anti-fascism of NieR Automata. The standard format for video essays on fascism demands that I start out by defining it. I'm going to try to mix it up a bit by doing that while simultaneously outlining how NieR Automata depicts fascism. Apologies if this is well-traveled ground for some of you, but I believe we need to establish this real quick. YoRHa, the military organization our player characters belong to, is a fascist state. Using the aspects enumerated by Umberto Eco in his seminal essay, Fascism, we see that YoRHa fits the bill exceptionally well. Fascist states and organizations are enamored with what Eco describes as the cult of tradition. Or in other words, fascists mythologize the past. The foundational belief of fascism is that some point in time in the past was perfect and has since been corrupted or degraded. The goal for fascists, then, is to restore this mythic past. YoRHa's stated mission is to drive the invading machine lifeforms off of Earth in an effort to restore a homeland for humanity, who we're told have since fled to the moon. So while YoRHa may not advocate for a well-defined cultural or social regression, it does endeavor to return to a previous political configuration. The mythic pasts of fascism are just that, myth. They're frequently gross exaggerations and mischaracterizations of history, if not outright fabrications. They do not withstand objective historical scrutiny. As such, fascism is frequently at odds with finding truth through rational and objective observation. Fascism, in response, muddies the waters. It does this by deliberately making objective truths harder to discern through misinformation and sophistry. The goal is to make it difficult for uninformed people to confidently and independently make decisions for themselves. Thus, they will fall back on the opinions of authority figures or other factionalized thinking. Along these lines, fascism deliberately undermines and attacks institutions of learning and truth-seeking. Academia, the sciences, the press, etc. The fascist worldview is reductionist and factional, celebrating simplistic solutions and impulsive action. Things such as scholarship, rigorous analysis, and independent verification frequently contradict such a worldview. Ergo, fascists will label intellectuals and people of strong moral integrity as corruptive or degenerative influences. How exactly YoRHa fits into these last two points is going to take some explanation, which we'll get into later. But for now, please take my word that YoRHa adequately fulfills these criteria. Expounding on the previous point, fascism does not suffer any criticism, no matter how legitimate.
Unit 8B specializes in close quarters combat. Proposal: destroy enemy with long-range attacks.
Destroy? What happened to detain?
With YoRHa, we see its violent suppression of deserters and dissidents in the YoRHa Betrayers and Amnesia sidequests, as well as a particular reveal later in the story. The next aspect is also a pretty straightforward one. Fascism relies on in-group, out-group dynamics, so bigotry and xenophobia are tools of the trade. YoRHa is an organization dedicated to eradicating a race of sentient beings, so check. Echo specifically mentions an appeal to a frustrated middle class, but I believe this can be expanded a bit. Fascists recruit people who feel anxious, embarrassed, humiliated, or are otherwise uprooted by the world changing around them. This point in particular is focused on people who find themselves neither at the top nor at the bottom of a vertical hierarchy, and who fear falling down said hierarchy. This is one point that I don't think YoRHa has the social or cultural dimensions to fully capture. There is an appeal to frustration regarding the fact that the machines captured the Earth, but that doesn't really replicate the class, race, and gender politics described here. So this is our first miss. Echo writes, "The only ones who can provide an identity to the Ur-fascist nation are its enemies." Fascists stoke these fears to the point of paranoia, that their enemies are from both without and within. Their adversaries are omnipresent, both barbarians at the gate and infiltrators working from within to subvert the fascist state. YoRHa's conflict seems completely external. Sure, it violently suppresses any dissent from within, but that's not quite what this point is about. YoRHa doesn't really have any kind of paranoia about the machines infiltrating their ranks. This one is also a no. Fascists require their opponents to be an existential threat needing to be stopped by any means necessary. Simultaneously, these enemies are also contemptibly weak. So when viewed in their might makes right ethos, they are worthy of eradication. This paradox leads fascist regimes to have very flawed threat assessment capabilities. It's hard to say if YoRHa engages in this shifting of rhetorical focus. As we learn later, its counterpart, the machine network, is deliberately weakening its forces. Thus, the machines really do fluctuate from these disorganized and peaceful goofballs to a military force of overwhelming number and scale. Let's mark this one as maybe. Fascist regimes must continually justify their ongoing consolidation of power. The most surefire way to do this is to be perpetually at war, and for the stakes of this war to involve the survival of the fascist nation itself. Ironically, winning this war now becomes just as catastrophic to the fascist regime as losing it does. Without this vital pretense, the power at any cost rationale falls apart. If you've already played NieR Automata all the way through, you're probably nodding along in recognition here. We'll dive into the story of the game in depth later, but suffice to say, this is a massive checkmark here. As previously mentioned when talking about its appeal to populist grievance, fascism relies on a structure of vertical hierarchy. The design of this hierarchy reinforces itself. As seen in multi-level marketing schemes, those in the middle feel the greatest investment in the hierarchy. They are more than happy to serve those above them because it means that they get to have power and privilege over those beneath them. Echo calls this populist elitism. This one doesn't really fit YoRHa either. Outside of the commander, YoRHa units don't appear to have rank over each other, making the org chart pretty flat overall. Within fascism, everyone is educated to become a hero. It's a clever way of getting a populace to dehumanize themselves. Their life doesn't belong to them, it belongs to the fascist state. Uplifting heroic sacrifice as the highest honor is a means to transform the citizenry of a fascist state into disposable pawns.
We're soldiers. We take pride in our service.
The Council of Humanity has a message for all of our brave androids fighting on the surface. Currently, our struggle against the machine life forms is at a stalemate. This battle has raged for far too long. I am sure all of you find the effort grueling. But now is not the time to give up. Now, more than ever, we must forge on. Remember that several hundred thousand humans on the moon want nothing more than to return to Earth. Glory to mankind.
In NieR Automata, we hear this very rhetoric from the assorted Council of Humanity communiques praising the noble sacrifice of the YoRHa androids. It should not be surprising that an ideology obsessed with the past also frequently enforces traditional or regressive gender politics. Many of the aspects of fascism we've described fit comfortably within patriarchal norms. The disdain for wimpy intellectuals, the glorification of war and strength in action, grievances over women and others not knowing their place in the social hierarchy. With YoRHa, Automata has a very particular way of satirizing this machismo, which we will be going in depth on in just a few. Fascist organizations love to uphold a nebulous will of the people, but as far as the democratic rights of its citizenry, not so much. As Echo explains, the people is only a theatrical fiction. Fascists posture themselves as interpreters of this vague common will as a way to perpetuate their control over their subjects. Again, there's not a lot of political or social dimensions to YoRHa, but the organization does act in the vague interest of all androids. This while also behaving callously and violently towards individuals in its ranks. Let's just say, maybe. Lastly, fascist states attempt to limit the imagination and critical thinking of their citizens through language, specifically using something akin to newspeak from George Orwell's 1984. By promoting an impoverished vocabulary and an elementary syntax, fascists aim to prevent the formation of criticism and dissent. It's hard to draw a parallel to YoRHa because, again, it doesn't really have a lot of depth as a social or cultural institution. This last point is a no. Let's go over our scorecard here. We have 8 yeses, 4 noes, and 2 maybes. Keep in mind that Umberto Eco argues that fascism can coalesce around just one of these behaviors. With that in mind, I'm comfortable making the argument that YoRHa is a fascist state.
Remember your pain. The pain of having your homeland stolen. We will never give up our struggle. We will take back the seas, the skies, the land. We will take back our world from the scourge of the machines. We will not fail in this mission. Here and now, we will put an end to this goddamn war. Glory to mankind.
Glory to mankind!
Automata has been analyzed through an assortment of lenses which speak to its incredible depth and relatability. The best of these, in my mind, is reading it as a satire of fascism, which, as we'll elaborate here, brings the entire work into focus. Everything from the narrative to the gameplay to the aesthetics serve this reading remarkably well. So let's get into how exactly NieR Automata satirizes fascism. Tackling political topics such as fascism in fiction can be somewhat precarious. Using a real-world nation or society as a setting is especially fraught. People are likely to react reflexively to any depiction of their own culture, closing off their minds before you even start telling your story. On the other hand, if the same things are shown in another real-world cultural context, they may miss the ways in which the story relates to their own society. Or worse, they may take whatever the narrative is attempting to convey and essentialize it to that culture. NieR Automata uses three different approaches in tandem to disarm its audience of their prejudices, so that it can satirize fascism with maximum impact. The first approach is a staple of its narrative genre. Science fiction has, to varying degrees of success, used allegory as a means to abstract and smuggle social and political commentary through the barriers of bias in its audience. Automata obfuscates the nature of its central struggle and the fascistic aspects of YoRHa with its premise of aliens, machines, androids, and so on. Secondly, Automata leverages video games' power of interactivity. It's natural for readers and watchers of fiction to relate to the protagonists of a story. We're seeing the world through their eyes, and sometimes through their thoughts. Adding interactive control on top of this can intensify the audience's projection into these characters or otherwise strengthen this parasocial bond. By placing our player characters into YoRHa, the game deliberately attempts to keep our preconceptions off balance. First-time players of Automata are likely to sympathize with YoRHa and its goals early on, making later story beats and reveals all the more impactful. The last technique of Automata's satirical subterfuge is absurdism. Using moments of silliness and offbeat humor, the game further confounds the audience's expectations and partiality.
How can we make him bigger? I don't know. We're too dumb to figure that out.
Sometimes this wackiness is used to accent the inherent ridiculousness of the fascist ideology it is satirizing.
To be here, what's wrong? I am definitely not the person to discuss this with.
Other times it behaves similarly to the sci-fi allegory as a means to derail any prejudiced thinking on behalf of the player. This absurdity also humanizes our subjects, making what happens to them more weighty.
Hey, mister, how do you make children?
Well, machines can't really make children. Neither can androids, now that I think about it.
Together forever, carry me.
2B? Little help here?
Huh? You're the chatty one. Work it out.
Oof.
Getting into the specifics of how Automata satirizes fascism, this absurdity is one of the first things to meet the eye. Remember how a common trait of fascist states is machismo, the embrace of hyper-masculine patriarchal ideals. With that in mind, something should jump out about Automata's depiction of a fascist organization.
Activating short-range attack gear.
Glory to mankind.
Glory to mankind.
Now that's a wave of destruction that's easy on the eyes.
YoRHa's ranks are overwhelmingly women, and the organization is unilaterally commanded by a woman, with its only masculine members being the scanner models like 9S, who are distinctly boyish in appearance. Not only is YoRHa mostly women, but these women also present in an overtly feminine manner. Their standard uniforms draw influence from EGL or elegant gothic Lolita styles, featuring skirts and leggings with plenty of lace and frill. Their combat armor borders on fetish attire with some skin-tight PVC-esque material, ensuring the feminine form comes through the stormtrooper getup. Now all of this can just be the result of director Yoko Taro being a horn dog, which, I mean, he is. But I don't think this is solely the reason why YoRHa looks this way, nor do I think it's solely a case of cynical sex appeal for the sake of grabbing attention and selling more copies. Fascism fetishizes military conflict, the hardware of war, and of course the ideal of the steadfast soldier. So what NieR Automata is doing here is literalizing this fetish, packaging its technologically advanced android combatants as objects of titillation. It should also be noted that Automata frequently lampoons common video game tropes. The blending of militaristic power fantasy with the sexual objectification of women, two things video games are wont to do, may be a big part of that. As mentioned before, I believe Yoko Taro and company are deliberately using irony as a means to keep the player off balance. In this case, it's the visual irony of this overwhelmingly feminine organization standing in for fascism, which in real life is commonly steeped in hypermasculinity. If YoRHa was full of lantern-jawed and muscle-bound men, its fascist proclivities would be much more apparent. As we'll discuss in a moment, although YoRHa has this outwardly feminine appearance, it espouses some very patriarchal beliefs. YoRHa's worldview is black and white. The in-group, humanity and its android forces, are good. The out-group, the aliens and their machine army, are bad. With this in mind, take a closer look at the color palette, or lack thereof, in and about YoRHa. While in the bunker, which is YoRHa headquarters, and in the more YoRHa-centric missions, the visuals go completely grayscale. When we enter situations of moral ambiguity, we return to the game's full gamut of color. Coming back to YoRHa's uniforms, we see the same thing. High contrast blacks and whites lacking color and shades of gray. And speaking of attire, let's take a closer look at the most iconic piece of clothing in NieR Automata, the combat blindfolds. Many people have remarked about them being too on the nose as a metaphor, reading them solely as the YoRHa forces being blind to the truth of their organization. I don't think this interpretation truly captures the full allegorical intent here. Rather than obscuring the YoRHa members from something external to them, these blindfolds are shrouding our characters from each other and from us, the audience. Think about how vital the eyes and upper part of the face are in identifying a person. Even further, remember that YoRHa restricts its members from expressing themselves.
I think it's more about the feeling behind it than the actual item, right?
Feelings are prohibited.
Yeah.
With this in mind, the blindfold's purpose becomes clearer. Think about how important our eyes and surrounding facial muscles are in expressing ourselves. The go-to example for this is the difference between a forced smile and a genuine one. Another tell comes when our player characters lose their blindfolds.
I'll tear you apart. Every last one of you!
It always ends like this.
These are usually moments where all artifice is dropped and they begin expressing their genuine emotions. This repression of emotion also serves the irony that these extremely feminine presenting characters behave as straight-laced, stern, and stoic soldiers, behaviors traditionally coded as masculine.
This job can be pretty rough sometimes, huh?
We don't get to choose our assignments, and you should work on keeping your opinions in check. YoRHa aren't allowed to be emotional, remember?
This is a real pain. May I remind you that personal chatter during operations is restricted?
Fine.
Say, how's the weather on Earth today? Good?
It's fine. Does that question have anything to do with our operation?
Not really. I just figured it might feel nice to have some good weather.
Feeling nice has no bearing on completing missions.
That is so like you to be. Anyway, talk to you later.
I contend that the YoRHa facial coverings serve to dehumanize our characters, especially combined with this overt objectification. These faceless dolls are a visual metaphor of how a fascist regime treats its heroes as disposable pawns. Fascism traffics in extremes, not just in its methodology, but also at the bedrock of its philosophy. We are fundamentally good. They are irredeemably bad. And these two groups are locked in an apocalyptic struggle. Either we succeed in eradicating them, or they will eradicate us. Black and white with no shades of gray. This worldview does not tolerate any difference of opinion, no matter how small or justified. It therefore excels in alienating supporters and allies. And with its need for conflict in an adversary, it constantly picks fights and makes new enemies. This all-or-nothing mindset of fascism then becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. There are two outcomes of fascist societies. The most common one is abject defeat by their growing list of enemies. But as mentioned earlier, victory is also rife with peril for fascists. With no more them to fight, fascism must find new adversaries. With no more enemies on the outside, a fascist society will cannibalize itself. So, in truth, there is only one terminus for fascism: death. This inevitable conclusion of fascism is at the heart of NieR Automata's narrative. Toward the end of Route B, we're treated to this memorable scene.
His wondrous grace has become a god. His grace. His wondrous grace has become a god.
Become a god.
His wondrous grace has become a god.
Become a god.
We as well shall become as gods.
Become as gods.
We as well shall become as gods.
Become as gods.
All
of you shall become as gods.
Become as gods.
All of you shall become as gods.
Become as gods.
All of you shall become as gods.
We'll
all die together and become as gods.
Oh dear.
I did this happen. The only option left is to die.
I'm scared. I'm so scared.
We must die and become gods.
Yes, let us die now.
Battles and adventures, the prophet spoke. Oh, grant me the mercy of the land. Oh, grant me the joy of the heavens. Release me from my yoke of iron. Thus shall our souls be saved. Forever and ever.
And then, shortly thereafter, we learn this.
I found records stating that the Council of Humanity was established as part of Project YoRHa, but I'd always heard it was the other way around. So did YoRHa actually create the Council of Humanity?
Yes. We installed the Council of Humanity's server on the surface of the moon.
But that means...
mankind no longer exists. In truth, humans never went to the moon at all. Any transmissions received from the moon are just dummy signals we set up in advance. The only thing there is a small bit of data relating to the human genome.
But why would you...
Humans were already extinct when the aliens attacked.
But why?
No one fights without a reason. And we need a god worth dying for. What path will you take? It's up to you to decide.
What a bizarre juxtaposition. I wonder if the game is trying to tell us something. Stick a pin in this, we'll get to it in a second.
They're still conscious.
Stay focused, 2B.
Coming back to Umberto Eco, his ninth aspect of fascism is especially interesting. For fascism, there is no struggle for life, but rather, life is lived for struggle. Thus, pacifism is trafficking with the enemy. It is bad because life is permanent warfare. This, however, brings about an Armageddon complex. Since enemies have to be defeated, there must be a final battle, after which the movement will have control of the world. But such a final solution implies a further era of peace, a golden age, which contradicts the principle of permanent war. No fascist leader has ever succeeded in solving this predicament. Permanent warfare describes the backstory of NieR Automata perfectly. The androids and the machine lifeforms have been warring since the aliens arrived on Earth, about 7 millennia before the events of the game. These two factions have been at war for so long that each side's original motivation has become irrelevant. The machines killed their alien masters thousands of years in the past, so who exactly are they conquering the Earth for anymore? YoRHa maintains the fascist aim of recreating a mythic past, the pretense of restoring humanity on Earth, although humanity was already extinct when the aliens arrived. What is keeping the androids and the machines from staring into the abyss is a sort of codependent antagonism between the two. An excerpt from the machine research report we received toward the end of the game explains it thusly.
At this point, machine lifeforms recognize that the goal of defeating the enemy actually required an enemy. In order to maintain this singular objective, they reached the contradictory conclusion that their current enemies, the androids, could not be annihilated completely, lest they no longer have an enemy to defeat.
In other words, this conflict provides meaning, warding off looming existential dread for both sides. So they're locked into a millennia-long war simply because they don't know what they'd do without it. Adding to this cruel irony is the fact that despite their exterior differences, the YoRHa androids and the machines are at their core the same. as in literally.
The YoRHa black box circuitry. It's made from cores from the machines? That's... no, that can't be true.
But this is also true in a figurative sense. As mentioned in the machine research report, the machine network at some point absorbed the Project Gestalt server, meaning that the machine network assimilated human memories into itself, making it a network of machines with the ghost of humanity at its core, per Jackass's description.
So, Jackass, was it?
So we have two sides that are more similar than different, acting out this sort of global-scale prisoner's dilemma. And in perpetuating this, each side is not just unnecessarily hurting its opponent, but also itself.
2B, I'm not quite sure what it means to mourn, or even if we have a soul to concern ourselves with. But I hope you're at rest, 2B. Sweet dreams. I'll be with you before long.
Umberto Eco calls fascism the cult of death. This not only describes the way that fascism exalts death and heroic sacrifice with religious reverence, but also in the way a cult punishes its defectors. In that regard, how YoRHa treats its own members reveals its fascist brutality in full. Our first potential glimpse of this cruelty is the side quest 11B's Memento. 11B is one of 2B's squadmates in the opening mission of the game, who gets shot down approaching the factory. The quest is given to us by what's later revealed to be her lover, 16D, imploring us to search for the missing in action 11B. We find 11B has passed away from her injuries, and through her data log learn that she was attempting to desert YoRHa during the factory mission. If the player opts to tell 16D about 11B's true motives, she acts delighted about 11B's demise, as if 11B deserved her fate for trying to desert. The next side quest following this theme is YoRHa Betrayers. We're told that three YoRHa combat models deserted the ranks and raided the resistance camp while doing so. 2B and 9S are then commanded to find and eliminate these renegades. Afterwards, resistance leader and enemy is unable to corroborate that these three YoRHa soldiers attacked or robbed the resistance in any way. Inquiring further with YoRHa Command, we find that additional information on the case has been restricted. Our final side quest along these lines is Amnesia, which, ironically, is one of the game's most memorable side quests. An android asks us to track down the person who murdered her friend. We soon learn that our quest giver was the culprit all along. Confronting her with this knowledge, she admits to regularly killing YoRHa members and purging her memory as a means to cope with her guilt and trauma. Because she is of a classified designation, a YoRHa Type E model, the E standing for execution. Type E's serve as YoRHa's secretly embedded political officers, hunting down and killing any android who deserts from YoRHa or who learns too much about the true nature of the organization. All this builds to the late game reveal that our player character 2B is not really 2B at all.
2B hated to keep killing you. It caused her so much pain. The 9S type is a high-end model. They knew you'd discover the truth eventually, but the model designation 2B was just a cover. The official designation is 2E, number 2 type E. They were a special class of members designed to execute YoRHa units. But you knew that, right, 9S?
Fascism is an engine of misery for all involved. Certainly for its out-group victims, but over long enough of a time, also its in-group participants. It can't help but be like this because it is a system that pursues power and control at the expense of literally everything else. Fascism, again, is a death cult, and YoRHa plays the role. At the start of Route C, Just when YoRHa is about to claim ultimate victory, it deliberately sabotages its effort. Opening a back door for the machine network to infiltrate, the YoRHa ranks are infected with a logic virus and annihilated. Fascism would rather die than to see a world where its pretense for power is gone. Hey there, folks. I hope you're enjoying the video. I'm looking to grow this channel, so if you could do that whole like, comment, and subscribe thing, that would be
peachy.
Thanks. We've mentioned before how perspective helps frame the story for the audience. We're likely to empathize with the characters we follow and see the fictional world they inhabit on their terms. This is why unreliable narrators and villain protagonists can be so effective in subverting expectations. Interactivity can strengthen this connection between protagonist and player. We're not just getting this character's perspective, we're partially acting as them. Through gameplay, their plight becomes our own. For instance, when Nines goes missing in the middle of Route A, his absence is palpable in that we no longer have a combat partner. That our player characters are YoRHa androids makes us much more susceptible to inhabit the YoRHa worldview.
But the humans on the moon? Now they are interesting.
Why them?
Because they are an enigma. They killed uncountable numbers of their own kind, and yet loved in equal measure. It's fascinating, don't you think? What could possibly drive such behavior? We have dedicated ourselves to unraveling this riddle of humanity. And now we will allow you to assist us. You were made in their image, after all.
Assist you with what?
It's simple. We need you to locate the humans on the moon and bring them to us. We will then dissect and analyze them in order to drag their secrets forth into the light. Surely you see the attraction in this.
Are you insane? We'd never do that!
After all, they're fighting for humanity, and those of us holding the controller are human. Video games also tend to be hero fantasies, taking our natural tendency to view ourselves as the protagonists of our own stories and projecting that onto our player characters. All this serves to make us pull the wool over our eyes, thinking that we are part of a good and just campaign in YoRHa, which makes the reveal later all the more dramatic. A common criticism of Automata is how its endings oddly partition the narrative. Routes A and B resemble something of an extended first act, and there's a myriad of ways to view the structure of the rest of the game. But when treating Automata as a fascist satire, there's a potential resonance of narrative with player experience using this structure. If the player just sticks to the main quests and puts down the controller after ending A, they'll probably find the experience underwhelming. Or in other words, if you operate under typical expectations of a video game and just follow orders, story progression, you'll get a box-checking experience. But if you are curious and pull on that thread in front of you, the facade of YoRHa begins to unravel. This is true as you proceed through Automata's five main endings, but even more pertinent if you dive into its side quests. The three side quests that we focused on in the narrative section can all be completed before the big reveal about the fate of humanity. From those quests alone, players will probably piece together that something is off with YoRHa.
Type E. I didn't know there was such a thing. Did you two be?
Some things are better left unknown.
Yeah, I suppose so.
Furthermore, Automata's side quests clash with YoRHa's black and white worldview. Frequently, they humanize the machine lifeforms and show us androids who are seeking alternatives to the forever war. The game consistently rewards us for our curiosity, our compassion, and our introspection, all things that are anathema to fascism. It encourages us to extrapolate these lessons onto the main plot of the game, and also onto our own lives. To the people who belong to the in-group of a fascist movement, there is an obvious appeal. especially in times of political upheaval, social change, and economic unrest, where fascism promises to turn back time and restore status, security, and privilege to such individuals. There's also a cult-like allure to fascism, latching onto people's desire to be part of something bigger than themselves. This is precisely why we cannot treat fascism solely as an external threat. Here in the United States, fascist rhetoric and ideology has taken hold of the Republican Party. And right here in my hometown, Nazis feel comfortable enough to be loud and proud in public, brazenly flying swastikas and anti-Semitic slogans for all to see. These enthusiastic out-in-public fascists aren't just ones who have been in hiding and now feel safe to parade their bigotry. They are recruiting, their numbers are growing, their beliefs are starting to gain traction in the mainstream. Elected officials are refusing to denounce them.
It is happening here.
We're seeing the GOP create laws and policies targeting LGBTQ+ folks, specifically children. In Texas, parents of trans children will be charged with child abuse for helping their children get gender-affirming care. Here in Florida, the Don't Say Gay bill just passed the state senate and will assuredly be signed into law by this sack of shit. This law aims to prevent teachers and school staff from discussing matters pertaining to sexual orientation and gender identity unless it meets the vague guideline of age-appropriate and developmentally appropriate. Certainly, this will serve to alienate and ostracize gay, trans, and queer students, and will likely jeopardize the jobs of LGBTQ teachers as well.
It is happening here.
When the Nazis first started their mass book burnings, what books did they burn? One of their first targets was the academic and scientific work of the Institute of Sexual Research, a nonprofit foundation which studied all manner of topics regarding sexual orientation and gender, and had developed such things as gender-affirming treatment and surgery. So I ask you, do Republican efforts to ban books and to create policies criminalizing LGBTQ people remind you of anything?
It is happening here.
Clearly, media depictions of the unfettered evil of Nazism have started to lose their cultural cachet. And while I wholeheartedly agree that anyone with a functional moral compass should be viscerally disgusted by fascism with no further argument needed, well, apparently that approach is not working anymore. We need to find a new tack. This is the real value of NieR Automata's satire. Because it shows us that not only has fascism never achieved its goals, it shows us that fascism can never do so. Fascism is the march to oblivion. Whatever promises it may make, the only things it can deliver are senseless conflict and death.
This is Project YoRHa. That means all of us. To be.
Now you know everything. Will you still wish to fight? We are conceptual human personalities created within the machine network. We cannot be destroyed. YoRHa Unit 9S. Your attack is meaningless. Your existence is meaningless.
Shut up!
Ending D punctuates NieR Automata's pitch-black satire of fascism. Our player characters are lying in pools of their own blood, their tragic motivations culminating in an outcome where no one wins. It's about as bleak as you can get. If the game ended here, Automata's evisceration of fascism would be nonetheless thorough and brilliant. But Yoko Taro and company are wisely not content with just a message of fascism bad. Instead, Automata goes on to argue for its antithesis. The remainder of Ending D finds us in the fleeting consciousness of 9S. We learn that the machine network created the tower to destroy the remnants of humanity on the moon. But the machines have changed their mind and have converted it into an ark. No longer a weapon of destruction, but a tool of survival. Adam and Eve live on in this ark, and they extend an olive branch to 9S, asking him to come along on their journey. Where once there was war, despair, and death, here now blooms peace, hope, and new life. After finishing the game's first four endings, we're treated to Automata's most affecting and important sequence, Ending E. The optimism of Ending D is pushed even further, transmuting Automata's overarching narrative from a superb satire to something transcendent.
Pod 042 to pod 153, data confirmed. Personal data for units 9S, 2B, and A2 appear to be leaking out.
Pod 153 to pod 042. Follow project rules and delete all personal data.
Pod 042 to pod 153. Personal data deletion request denied.
Pod 153 to pod 042. Failure to parse statement.
Pod 042 to pod 153. There was data created in my banks as I was referencing the records. I realize something. I have come to the conclusion that I cannot accept this resolution.
The destruction of all YoRHa units is an essential component of the project plan. All data must be destroyed.
Pod 042 to pod 153. Repeat. Personal data deletion request denied. Initiating data salvage. Pod 153. You hoped they would survive as well, didn't you?
We lack the authority for such an action. The rules are protected by low-level systems. Salvaging data poses an unacceptable level of risk. Knowing that, do you still wish for them to survive?
Maybe if I keep believing, my dreams will come to life.
We find ourselves in the twin-stick shooter mode used during the hacking segments of the game. But this time, our opponents are the creators of the game itself, shown in the form of the game's credits, shooting shmup bullets at us. It's a deliberately overwhelming challenge, bordering on impossible. After each failed attempt, we receive messages from other players encouraging us to press on. After a few more failed attempts, we're eventually offered help. Accepting this help, fellow units bearing the screen names of other players swoop in, boosting our firepower and taking damage in lieu of us. This trivializes the previously insurmountable challenge, and at last we defeat the developers of the game. We override their will and get our happy ending. The devastating conclusion of the game's events is reversed and our protagonists are brought back to life. Afterwards, the game asks us if we want to help other players in the same way that we were just helped. There's a catch to this, however. Doing so will cost our save data, and we will have no control over who we will be helping. The game deliberately probes this last point. Are you okay making this sacrifice, even if it helps out someone you may hate or someone who hates you? Do you still want to do this even though there is no longer any benefit in it for you? To me, there has never been a more powerful sequence in a video game. The way Ending E masterfully melds mechanics with metaphor is a monumental moment for the medium. It's incredible in isolation, and a tour de force when placed in the context of Automata's grand narrative. Ending E transforms NieR Automata from a grim satire of fascism into a powerful and poignant piece of anti-fascist art. Because anti-fascism is not just punching Nazis or directly opposing fascist efforts, though don't get me wrong, that's an important part of it. Anti-fascism is a repudiation of fascism's core tenets on a fundamental level. And this is why Ending E embodies the heart of anti-fascism. It encourages us to let go of our prejudices, to open up and be vulnerable, to pay it forward instead of playing a zero-sum game. It is about overcoming the widespread alienation and atomization we experience as individuals in this world, to reconnect with our fellow human beings in solidarity and community. It is about unlearning the conditioning that makes us bigoted and hateful and selfish, replacing it with a love and compassion for all humanity. If fascism is the cult of death, then anti-fascism must be a force for life.
However, the possibility of a different future also exists. A future is not given to you. It is something you must take for yourself.